The vertebrate spinal cord integrates sensory information from the body. It can coordinate reflexes at the level of the spinal cord. It will also relay the information to the brain. The spinal cord also carries descending information from the brain to the spinal cord, directing the activity of muscles and other tissues. In this video, we're going to look at the functional anatomy of the vertebrate spinal cord. Well, let me begin by showing you an MRI. Here, you can see the brain at the top of the figure. Here's the cerebellum, the pons, and the medulla. And then continuous with the medulla is a column of tissue. This is the spinal cord. Like the brain, the spinal tissue is surrounded by three protective meninges layers, and it's bathed with cerebrospinal fluid, which is continuous with that in the brain. In adult humans, the spinal cord ranges from about 42 to 45 centimeters in length. It depends on how tall you are. It's about 1 centimeter in diameter, but this varies depending on where you are along the length of the spinal cord, and I'll tell you about that later. We can see in this figure that the spinal cord is really a column of tissue. Nevertheless, it's referred to as a segmented structure. The reason it's segmented is because the axons that are carrying sensory information into the spinal cord and the axons that are carrying output from the nervous system to the periphery have to exit. And the space that they do this will be between these vertebrae. And so the nerves that leave the spinal cord do this in a segmented fashion. Humans have a total of 31 spinal nerves, 8 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral, and 1 coccygeal. Students in human anatomy often learn the mnemonic that we have breakfast at 8 o'clock, we have lunch at 12 o'clock, we might have an early dinner at 5, to help remember the number of spinal nerves. There is a relationship between the spinal nerves and the vertebrae, but there are also some exceptions that are worth talking about. So one difference is that there are only 7 cervical vertebrae, while there are 8 segments in the cervical part of the spinal cord. Another difference is that while the vertebral column runs all the way down to the tailbone, the spinal cord itself is not quite this long. It terminates earlier, although the space lying underneath this may still have the spinal nerves because they'll exit between the vertebrae further down. I'm going to switch to a mouse model to show you a little bit more about this. This is an image from Harrison and her colleagues' work, and they did MRI studies on mice to identify landmarks. So just to orient you, the brain of the mouse is up here. And if we zoom in on this section of the mouse, we'll see the tissue. Let me orient you. Here, for example, is the 13th thoracic vertebrae. I picked this on purpose because I wanted to remember to tell you that different vertebrate species have different numbers of vertebrae and different numbers of spinal segments. While humans have 12 thoracic segments, mice have 13, and there's a corresponding 13th spinal segment. We can see it up here, and you can see that it's not lined up with the vertebrae. Instead, the part of the spinal cord that's lying near T13 is actually the 4th and the 5th spinal lumbar segments. The nerve from the 13th segment will still travel down and exit, though, between T13 and L1 vertebrae. Well, let's return to humans for a closer look at the tissue. I'm going to begin by showing you this ventral view, meaning we're looking at it from the front, and we'll work up from the bottom. So the spinal cord, like the brain, is surrounded by 3 layers of meninges. There's the dura mater, lying underneath it, the arachnoid layer, and then the pia mater would be close up against the tissue, and the space between the pia mater and the arachnoid layer would be filled with cerebrospinal fluid. These are the trunks of the spinal nerves that are coming off in that segmented structure. I've labeled these mixed spinal nerves because remember they're going to carry sensory information into the spinal cord as well as carrying motor information out of the spinal cord. Although ultimately that information is mixed up in the spinal nerves, close to the spinal cord itself it's segregated so that the dorsal rootlets carry in sensory information while the ventral rootlets will carry out motor output. Each spinal nerve is associated with a swelling called the dorsal root ganglion. A ganglion, remember, is a cluster of the cell bodies of neurons that lie in the peripheral nervous system, and these are going to be the neurons that send their axons in through the dorsal rootlets. In the cross-section, we can see that there's white matter, gray matter, and we can further divide the gray matter into what's called the dorsal horn and a ventral horn. Well, let me show you an actual image. This is a posterior view now of a human cadaver, and we can see the dura mater that's been peeled away to reveal the dorsal rootlets, and here are the dorsal root ganglia repeated on that segmental pattern. Let's look at the anatomy in a little more detail, switching to a cartoon now. So here's our dorsal root. This will be the ventral root. And here's the central canal, a fluid filled, a cerebrospinal fluid filled tube that will run the length of the spinal cord. Well, here's the dorsal root ganglion. Remember I said it has the cell bodies of sensory neurons. So here they are. There are hundreds of them. And I've colored them different colors because there are different types of sensory input. We get input about touch, about temperature, about pain, and proprioception, our body sense, where our limbs and joints are in space. These neurons carry information into the spinal cord where they synapse onto interneurons lying in the dorsal horn. Some of this sensory information also has an axon branch that will enter one of these white matter columns and project all the way to the brain. Other sensory neurons come in, make synapses onto interneurons, and those interneurons will cross and then enter a white column and again project up to the brain. What I want you to take away right now is that the dorsal horn is filled with local and projection interneurons. In the ventral horn, we find different class of neurons. These are called motor neurons. Some of them will innervate skeletal muscle fibers. Others will exit the spinal cord and travel to autonomic ganglia. Ultimately, these might control heart rate, breathing, digestion, and many other visceral functions. So these are called the motor neurons, and they lie in the ventral horn. I'm going to remove those labels and then just add a few more details. So looking at the gray matter, we've got the dorsal horn, it's processing sensory information, and then the ventral horn containing the cell bodies of these motor neurons. Well, if you think about the fact that the different parts of the gray matter are doing different things, some have local interneurons, some have motor neurons, you might expect that there would be differences in the cytoarchitecture, and there are. When the fine scale structure of the spinal cord is examined, you can see that it's a laminar structure, a layered structure, and these are called rexid laminae after the anatomist who first described them, and we represent them with Roman numerals ranging from 1 to 10. In the dorsal horn, we'll have layers 1 through 5, and then the larger Roman numerals like 9 and 10 will lie either in the ventral horn, or 10 is this region right around the central canal. Some of these layers are known by other names. So for example, layer 1 is also called the marginal zone. Layer 2 is called the substantia gelatinosa. Layers 3 and 4 contain the nucleus proprius. And lamina 9 contains the cell bodies of the skeletal motor neurons. The white matter is also organized. We can divide it into three broad anatomical regions. The dorsal column, it's also called the dorsal funiculus. The lateral column and the anterior column. We saw the nervous system keep sensory and motor information separate when it enters and leaves the spinal cord, and this is true in the white matter as well. Some parts of the white matter carry sensory information up to the brain. We call these ascending pathways. Other parts of the white matter carry information from the brain and the brain stem down to the spinal cord. We call this descending information. And you can see that these are kept separate, so that the dorsal column is purely sensory, whereas the lateral and anterior columns have a mix of ascending and descending information. In addition to these broad divisions between sensory ascending information and motor descending information, there are even finer scale divisions. For example, information about pain coming from our nociceptors and temperature terminate in lamina 1 and 2 of the spinal cord, whereas information from touch and pressure tends to go to layers 3 and 4. Similarly, in the ventral horn, where we have all the motor neurons that lie close to the midline tend to innervate proximal targets. By that I mean the core body and muscles close to the midline, such as maybe the shoulder or your rib muscles. Motor neurons that lie further to the side tend to have more distal targets, such as your hands and fingers or your feet and your toes. The white matter also shows specialization. If we look at the dorsal column and the anterolateral tract, we'll also see a mapping of the information. Here it's based on body position. The most sacral information is closest to the midline, and then from the lumbar, the thoracic, and the cervical region. There's a similar arrangement in the anterolateral tract, again with the cervical closest to the gray matter, and information from further closest to the edge of the spinal cord. There's a similar arrangement that we find in descending tracts. So here's a lateral corticospinal tract, and here again, information that will descend to the cervical segments lies closer to the gray matter than the axons that will travel all the way down and make synapses in the sacral region of the spinal cord. Remember at the beginning of the video I said that the spinal column was about 1 centimeter in diameter, but that varied depending on where you are? Well, when we look at the spinal cord, we see two enlargements, one around the cervical region and one around the lumbar region. And these correspond to the spinal segments that contain the motor neurons that actually innervate our arms and our legs. Here what I've done is to go to the mouse spinal atlas and put together composites of sections through the mouse spinal cord at four different regions. So we'll have stained pictures through cervical, thoracic, lumbar, and sacral regions of the spinal cord. And in order to make these figures, what I did was I actually pasted two figures together. So I have both the image that's Nissl stained, so we know where the cell bodies are, as well as tissue that's been stained for acetylcholinesterase activity. And that tells us where neurons that are using acetylcholine are. So what do we see? Well, the first thing I want you to notice is that there is a big difference in the size of the ventral horn between a segment from the cervical enlargement and the lumbar enlargement than there is between one that was taken at a level of a thoracic or a sacral section through the spinal cord. And the reason for that is because the ventral horn contains those motor neurons, and there are a lot of muscles in the arms and the legs, and so we have motor neurons to control that. When you look at the pictures, you'll see that the cells that are staining in the cervical and in the lumbar enlargement are these large neurons. That's what motor neurons look like. And not only that, there's a high amount of acetylcholinesterase activity, and that's the transmitter that motor neurons will use. The thoracic and the sacral segments have motor neurons, but not as many. Notice also that there's a difference in the size of the dorsal columns. Close to the top of the spinal column, we have information from the sacral regions, the lumbar regions, the thoracic regions, and the cervical regions. All has entered the spinal cord and all needs to be carried up. But a section through the lumbar region has only received sensory information from the sacral and the lumbar segments so far. We see a similar thing if we look at the anterolateral parts of the white matter. Remember, this is where we see a lot of descending tracts. And in the thoracic region, there's relatively more white matter than there is in the sacral region. And that's because there are more neurons that are going to make synapses onto spinal segments in the higher regions, whereas relatively few axons will need to descend all the way down and make synapses in the sacral region. The columnar arrangement of the spinal cord has really important clinical implications. Some of you may already be familiar with consequences of a spinal injury. Injury high in the spinal cord can affect the ability to breathe and head and neck movements. It might not be compatible with life. Damage to the spinal cord further down may damage hand or finger movement, but leave the essential functions of breathing as well as head and neck movements intact. Damage further down might affect hip motion. That occurs at the level of lumbar 2, knee extension, lumbar 3 segment, foot motion, down in the lumbar and sacral region. In individuals who damage the very caudal part of the spinal cord can affect a number of parasympathetic functions, including bowel and bladder activity, as well as penile erections. We'll come back to some of these topics in a later video.